MGTV y Homogénea con Dazas.
This is our 2017 annual scholarship symposium. Tonight we will be talking about endocrine problems and reproductive endocrinology and some issues in gynecology, as we will have a delightful panel and our distinguished physician of 2017, Dr. Kofi Nas.
So tonight we're privileged again to be able to do the Hellenic Medical Society Scholarship Awards. My name is Sotiris Tergiopoulos. I am the chairperson for the scholarships. We're very honored to be able to give awards to so many great medical students, as well as also some high school students that have written some great essays. There's a wonderful also documentary that's being shown tonight that we should take also notice of. And in general, the more, as the years go by, we see more and more great students. We see more and more great promise for our future, and especially for our Hellenic heritage. And seeing our strength in medicine is a wonderful thing. So it's great to give back to students, and hopefully they'll do that as well one day. Thank you very much.
So this evening we're celebrating the 81st Scholarship Awards Dinner for the Hellenic Medical Society of New York, which is a special honor. The Hellenic Medical Society of New York is the largest Hellenic medical society outside of Greece, with a membership which now is in excess of 300 members, active members, and a mailing list which of course is much, much larger. We've been in the fortunate position to support our young students and future colleagues with scholarships over many years. And again, this year, we're honored and also in a very happy position to offer scholarships to high school students and also to medical students in the tri-state area. This is very promising. These are future colleagues who will maintain the society and who also will continue to serve the community in the tradition of Hippocrates and the Hippocratic ideals.
I'm George Dangas, cardiologist at Mount Sinai Hospital in New York, and one of the past presidents of the Hellenic Medical Society. Great honor for me. As usual, this year we have the celebration weekend. Friday evening, we have a CME program. This year, the great topic and a great colleague, distinguished colleague, Dr. George Kofi Nas, and the Kofi Nas Fertility Group will give us the academic presentation on infertility and ways to overcome it. And very importantly, we have all the students of all kinds, from high school all the way to med school and all sorts of levels in between, that they receive awards, prizes, scholarships due to their achievement, due to their interest in the Hellenic ideas, their interest in the great essays they write on Hippocratic Oath, research plans, and different type of submissions that they do according to their level. We have a great diversity, which is very important, and a great number of awardees this year. And I would like to give my wholehearted congratulations to all of them for their achievement as well as their interest to come and learn about the Hellenic Medical Society, its ideals, the goals, and hopefully to become a member of the society and also recruit more members or their friends in the medical school or the college or any other school that they attend. And this was the very first publication of the Hellenic Medical Society of a book. The book was ultimately published in 2009, and we completed it during my tenure, 2005 to 2008. And of course, it's of great importance because Dr. Papanikolaou was our founder of the society and a famous pathologist all over the world. And I was very pleased to learn during my presidency tenure that Dr. Vassilas had been working on this for a long time. And I, with great pleasure, I made everything possible to congratulate him for these efforts and work towards the minor work, really, compared to what he had done, towards the completion of this project and the ultimate publication of the book. I'm very proud of it, and I'm extremely proud of the contribution and the initiatives Dr. Vassilas had in getting the idea and getting everything done for its translation.
Dr. Anthony Vassilas is fondly remembered by all the members of the Hellenic Medical Society of New York. I also had the good fortune to have him as a mentor during my period of introduction to the Hellenic Medical Society. And we also acknowledge his work both in supporting Greek communities outside of the United States in the diaspora through books and through other communications. But he also was very instrumental in bringing the tree, the Hippocratic tree from Kos, which came to the Medical College at New York Medical College, and was planted there, following up on his work to popularize the Hippocratic Oath and the Hippocratic ideals and make them known also to the American medical community in New York as an embodiment of all that we cherish, and also in recognition of the work of the Hellenic Medical Society of New York. Of course, he was also very much supportive of the work of Dr. George Papanikolaou, and he was part of the group that made sure that Dr. Papanikolaou's seminal contributions were acknowledged properly again at the university where Dr. Papanikolaou had much of his career.
Is to remind you all how proud I am, the board is, and all the parents and friends and physicians and future colleagues are of our scholarship recipients. Welcome. Welcome to our annual 2017 Scholarship Symposium. You didn't come to hear me speak, so I'm not going to speak much longer. But I did want to thank everybody that's involved. Absolutely the biggest thanks, of course, to the Scholarship Committee, in particular to Sofia Yostadiopoulos, Dr. Stadiopoulos, who you'll see him later, to Dr. Lorraine Yusomalis Vassalialis. Balasialis, you know, I always type that wrong too when I send you patients. If it's not for our scholarship committee and for the entire board who discusses these fine, fine students, I guess we wouldn't be here tonight. And most of all, of course, to our administrator, Evangelia Savadas, where are you? Oh, there she is. Yes, if it wasn't for Evangelia, we wouldn't even have these scholarship recipients because they wouldn't know that the application exists. But suffice it to say, we hope that all of these scholarship applicants tell their friends, because I'm sure that many of you know a potential scholarship recipient that did not either know or did not apply. So our main mission and the board's biggest, strength is to try to identify these future leaders, and we need your help to do so. So thank you very much for all of your support. Let's get the program underway. I also want to thank the people that were involved with tonight's event, in particular with Dr. Stefanidis, who is right there. Thank you for bringing us food. Thank you to Mr. and Mrs. John Kalabakos, to Mrs. Filanti. So for our honorees, one of whom is speaking tonight on our panel, and our keynote speaker, Dr. Kofi Nas, we congratulate you. There's a few moments in tonight that we also want to bring up some past people that are involved. But for the most part, our main tribute tonight is to the students. So, Lorraine, let me have you come up and begin the show.
George. On behalf of the Scholarship Committee of the Hellenic Medical Society, I'd like to welcome all of you here tonight. I am so overwhelmed with the turnout here tonight. I am so very proud. In the last year, we've started a young initiative project that has grown immensely, and between the social media and our exuberant Kelly Yehudis and a lot of the other scholarship recipients, I don't want to name them all and bore you, but you'll meet them very soon after the gala and the evening here tonight. Since 1975, the Hellenic Medical Society has been awarding scholarships to exceptional students, both high school students, medical students, and research scientists for their groundbreaking contributions to medicine and science. This year, our Distinguished Physician Award goes to Dr. George Gofinas for his excellence in the field of obstetrics and gynecology and subspecialty in infertility and reproductive medicine. Dr. Gofinas is founder and medical director of the Gofinas Fertility Group, which was established in 1987. He got his medical degree from the University of Athens in 1975 and came to the U.S. to pursue his specialty in obstetrics and gynecology and subspecialty in reproductive endocrinology and fertility at SUNY Downstate. In 1987, he was appointed director of the Reproductive Endocrinology Department at Brooklyn Hospital, and in 1996, he was appointed chairman and residency program director. Dr. Kofinas is a reproductive microsurgeon and has helped in develop minimally invasive surgical techniques to treat infertility, endometriosis, and pain. He is a member and fellow of numerous medical associations and is internationally renowned for his work in minimally invasive reproductive surgery, assisted reproductive technology, and fertility preservation. Dr. Kofinas has trained over 110 residents and has received multiple professional and excellence in teaching awards and has been included in New York Magazine's Best Doctors in New York for 19 consecutive years. I don't think I know very many other doctors that have done it for that long. So kudos to you. Dr. Kofinas and his group operate three reproductive medical centers in New York, Brooklyn, and Staten Island, and are opening their flagship center and headquarters in Lower Manhattan very soon. Dr. Kofinas has treated thousands of patients and has brought the miracle of life to many childless couples. So without further ado, our distinguished guest and honored physician, Dr. Kofinas.
I would like to thank the President of the Medical Society, the Medical Society, Dr. George Yakeas, the board of the Medical Society, Dr. Chris O'Malley's, and Dr. Stelioplos for inviting me here tonight to be the keynote speaker of the annual scientific meeting of the Society. I am honored and humbled to be in front of an audience like this, which includes exceptional physicians, and I will present to you the importance and the impact of genetics in reproductive medicine. This is a picture of the laboratory where the embryo that resulted in a pregnancy and the birth of the first IVF baby was created. This is Dr. Robert Edwards, the person in charge of the laboratory that he did practically most of the work, along with his co-workers, a team that created the first IVF baby and opened the door to a tremendous improvement in the reproductive medicine and fertility and an explosive growth that followed in that field, which it continues today unabated. The previous picture shows a laboratory where you can see cramped there on the shelves of and exposed equipment, books, and everything else you can imagine. The people working in the laboratory, they wear street clothes. There is a window over there, you can see something in the background. And in general, everything is cramped in a very small space. That's where the first embryo was created. In this laboratory here, you see that Everybody wears surgical attire, operating room attire. There are no books, there are no papers, there is nothing in there other than surfaces that can be cleaned and sterilized, no windows, and the lighting is dim because excessive light harms the embryos. In a modern IVF laboratory, and this is that the space that contains the equipment is hermetically sealed from anything else in the building, and the air that circulates into the laboratory is 100% pure air, which means that it's free of volatile organic compounds, chemicals, viruses, and bacteria. This air is filtered through several rows of carbon and carbon filters and permanganate filters, and finally HEPA filters to reduce and, if possible, eliminate the introduction of virus and bacteria into the laboratory. Following that, they are bombarded with UV lighting, which indeed creates a sterile environment, so nothing comes into the laboratory that might harm the embryos or slow their growth. We have come a long way, by the way. In the United States, after the Second World War, we experienced a boom in birth rates, which peaked around 1957 with a birth rate of approximately 123 babies per 1,000 women of reproductive age. After that, the birth rate declined dramatically, and within less than 20 years, we had a drop almost 50% in birth rate, down to 67 babies per 1,000 women of reproductive age. The birth rate remained low since 1977, with minimal peaks and valleys, and that drop in birth rate is the result of multiple factors, mostly socioeconomical, but also medical factors. The extreme rise of infectious diseases, sexually transmitted infectious diseases in the 60s and 70s that created a large number of patients, that of women that had damaged fallopian tubes blocked or damaged and became infertile. The only way that one can help those women conceive, even at the days that I started my training in reproductive medicine, was surgical correction of the problems utilizing microsurgery. The results of the surgical treatment ranged between dismal and good, depending on the extent of the damage and the skills and the talent of the microsurgeon. As you can understand, a large number of couples were left out and they couldn't have children because nothing could be done at the time. Until 1978, when Dr. Edwards and Dr. Steptoe announced the birth of the first baby, conceived by in vitro fertilization and transferred to the uterus via the cervix, bypassing completely the fallopian tubes. On the right side of the slide, you can see that the miscarriage rate of pregnancies increases dramatically from as age increases. At the age of 20, you have an approximately 10% of the pregnancies that end up as miscarriages. And at the age of 45, you have a miscarriage rate that approaches 90%. Of course, the curve becomes steep after the age of 40. And if you look at the lower graph, you can see that depicts the fertility rates and the number of the percentage of the patients that have infertility at different age groups. The age group below 30, it's 7%. 35-11%. Then it jumps 300% up to 33% of all the reproductive age women in that group. And at the age group of 40 to 45 is practically 87%. Extremely difficult for anyone to conceive. This graph, I depict the pregnancy rates in patients of all age groups that conceive using their own eggs. It is this curve over here. As you can see, the pregnancy rate early in patients younger than 30 years of age that undergo the IVF treatment and with embryo that were created by their own eggs is quite high, 50% approximately, and then gradually declines and it dives quite abruptly after the age of 37. Of course, age 44 to 45, it becomes practically zero. Now, if you take the same groups of women that now we make them pregnant utilizing donor eggs, eggs of young women that donate their eggs and fertilize and create embryos, you can see that the pregnancy success rate is practically the same across all the age groups. When we started utilizing the donor eggs to make patients pregnant, patients that are older, we could not imagine that this is what we're going to see. We thought that it's going to be more or less parallel to the other curve, but a little bit higher rates. It was not. It was flat, and it was the same in all the age groups, and the only thing that made the difference was the quality of the egg, because it came from a young woman, in contrast to the others that conceived using their own eggs that came from their own eggs. And the results were really cool. In reproductive medicine, we have a few problems that we have to address all the time. One is success rate. Somebody comes to us, wants to get pregnant, wants to have a baby. The other one is the control of multiple pregnancies. And the third one is the reduction of the pregnancy loss or miscarriage rate. In order to address this, we, for many years, for the last 25 years, scientists all over the world and everybody tried to identify or devise a method to be able to identify the embryos with the highest potential of starting a pregnancy. And needless to say, all methods that we tried failed miserably, and we end up without anything to help us really pick up the best embryo to increase the number, the success rate, decrease the number of embryos we put in, so we would decrease the multiple pregnancy rate and decrease the miscarriage rate. Until we started playing with biopsy of the embryo, once certain techniques were developed that will allow us to examine the chromosome complement of an embryo on a single cell. Here in this slide, I depict the different techniques that were developed over the years. And of course, the very first one that was developed to allow us now to experiment and test genetically the embryos was the FISH. The FISH, which stands for fluorescent in situ hybridization. The first test that allowed for aneuploid detection in interface nuclei, which eliminated the need to punch the cells and provided results in 2-3 days instead of 2 to 3 weeks. The range of the detection with utilizing this technique was somatic chromosomal aneuploidies, deletions, duplications, as well as transcriptions. There are some negatives with this technique, such as chromosomal aneuploidy is difficult with FISH, and nucleotide mutations in single cells and PGD for single gene disorders require micro-sequencing. which is another step, and all the problems that come with this and the expenses. This is schematically the FISH technique. In short, what we do is we take DNA known sequences, we tag them, then we denature it, and we take the cell that we have to test, put it on a slide, denature it, and hybridize it with the known sequences of DNA, and utilize antibodies that carry with them molecules of fluorescent substances. We tag now the DNA sequences. That way, by looking at the color of the fluorescence when you look under the microscope, we can tell which chromosome it is. And I'll show you here a picture of a karyotype which was created utilizing FISH technology. And you can see here that each region of each chromosome has a different color which identifies it. And that way we can tell which chromosomes are present, how many of them, if there are deletions, additions, duplications, or even translocations. Now, trisomy 16 can be seen in this particular segment, and trisomy 18 in the other one. They are very common trisomies in miscarriages. Multiple abnormalities can be detected simultaneously as every chromosome can be visualized with this technology. So if you have one embryo that you can have a deletion of one chromosome, an addition of another, or other multiple chromosomal abnormalities, like polyploidy, you can visualize them. The gender of an embryo can be detected by looking at the genetic chromosomes. And you can see the X here, one pair of chromosomes, whereas the Y is missing. The major issue with the FISH technology is that chromosomes can overlap, and whereas you have two of them, you might think that you have only one chromosome, and that's a drawback which reduces the accuracy of the procedure. Several other techniques were developed. One of them was the PCR technique. Another one was the ACGH, which stands for Comparative Genomic Hybridization. And the latest technique that we use now in testing our embryos is the so-called NGS, or next-gen sequencing. Array comparative genomic hybridization is the advanced form of the comparative genomic hybridization, or CGH, which requires whole genome amplification, which means that when you have one cell and you have an X amount of DNA, you cannot really test it unless you amplify it, which means you have to create many, many copies of the same DNA in order to be able to utilize the technology and identify the chromosomes. To overcome these resolution problems, the RACGH was developed, which is a much more accurate and, I would say, more efficient test that allows us to detect easier, faster, and more accurately abnormalities. And it can detect abnormalities as low as 200 base pairs, which means you can focus on genes, single genes. This is the technology in schematic presentation. When, let's say, you want to detect whether or not one cell has a certain cancer. If you want to detect if a certain cell has cancer genes, you add the markers, the DNA sequences that are characteristic for the trait that you're looking for, along with DNA sequences that are normal, hybridize it, and then, depending on the presence or absence of these markers, you get green, for example, or that means absolutely normal, or red, which means that we have the sequences you're looking for, let's say, for cancer. Next-gen sequencing. The human genome was mapped in 2003. took approximately 30 years or more, millions and millions of dollars, and the method that was used was the Sanger method, the Sanger sequence method, developed by Nobel laureate Fred Sanger. Essentially, the prime edited plate was used along with nucleotides to sequence as anode. That way, they developed the markers for prime, and they identified every gene in our genome. At that time, to do whole genome sequencing would cost millions, if I'm not mistaken, and then gradually the cost came down, up to the point that right now it might cost just a couple of thousand dollars. NGS is the next gen technology, allows for whole genome coverage in a fast, efficient, and inexpensive way. Libraries of DNA have been created by taking the genome of interest and creating DNA fragments. These DNA fragments are then tagged and then they are put through the PCR procedure. Sequencing can be done in many different ways, with the most commonly used methods incorporating a primer and fluorescent tag that is detected by four color imaging. This is the technology, and you can see the four different colors, chromatin, and the problems or errors or defective genes. PGS. What is PGS? What is PGD? What is when do we use one and when do we use the other? PGS is basically a genetic screening of cells of the embryo. Basically, what you do is you look at the karyotype to see if there are chromosomes missing, or if there are chromosomes added, or any combination of chromosomal abnormalities. So, by doing the PGS test, you know if an embryo is chromosomally normal, or if it is chromosomally abnormal. Of course, if it is chromosomally abnormal, it either does not start a pregnancy, or if it starts a pregnancy, it will end up as a miscarriage at an early stage of gestation, up to 8-9 weeks, with very rare exceptions such as the trisomy 21, where we have Down syndrome with those pregnancies and internal deliveries. PGD is a different test. Different because it does not look at the entire complement of chromosomes to see if we have extras or missing. It looks at specific locations in chromosomes, trying to identify the presence or absence of single genes. You can do it for one gene, you can do it for more than one. And I will give you an example. Let's say you have a couple that both of the parents are carriers of the thalassemia genes. Now, they have a risk of having a child with the disease. Also, they can have a perfectly normal child, or they can have a child that is a carrier, depending on the combination of the back of the chromosomes, normal and carrier chromosomes. Now, when we are dealing with a couple like this, and that's only one disease, and I mention it because it's very familiar to everybody that is of Greek or Mediterranean origin, when the gold standard of technology that we utilize in 2017 for the PGS is NGS technology. The same thing also with PGD, but we follow a different methodology. Now, with PGD, we require a little bit more tissue from the embryo in order to have enough DNA to do the test in an accurate and efficient way. This graph shows pregnancy rates of patients their eggs without testing the embryos for chromosomal normalcy. And another group that tested their embryos and they had embryo transfer of a chromosomally normal embryo. You can see that in all age groups, the green, which is embryo transfer with normal embryos, shows a much higher pregnancy rate compared to untested embryos, and it becomes much more pronounced at the older patients where, when you transfer a normal embryo, now the age practically does not have much to do, because you know that you have a normal embryo, and we know that the failure to conceive at older ages is secondary to abnormal embryos created by aged eggs. So as we can see here, on patients larger, older than 42, you have a much higher success rate than with tested embryos than we have with embryos that were not tested. This is another graph that shows the difference in miscarriage rates, pregnancy loss, in patients that were transferred embryos without testing them, without doing PGS, in contrast to patients that had embryo transfer with PGS. As I showed in the previous slides, the miscarriage rate increases dramatically with age, reaching 90% at the age of 45. PGS decreases the miscarriage rate down to 12.5%, or even lower, depending on the age group. This particular chart shows the miscarriage rates with the ACGH technology. So the embryos were tested using ACGH technology. Remember, now we move on to a new technology called NGS. You see here that the miscarriage rates in the group that received embryos that were not tested, let's take the group of 35-37 years of age, was 17%, compared to only 30% with the group that had transfer of normal embryos. If you go to the age group 41-42, you see that the miscarriage rate is 35 plus, and the miscarriage rate in tested embryos is less than 5%. This is an incredible advantage. This is an incredible advantage for several reasons. You don't waste time transferring abnormal embryos that either will not create a pregnancy or they will create a pregnancy that will fail and end with a miscarriage. And on the other hand, you know that you most probably will not have to do invasive procedures on patients older than 35 years of age to detect whether or not there is a chromosomal abnormality. Human embryo biopsy. A discovery worthy of another Nobel Prize? I'm not so sure about that, but it's something that maybe we should really think about in the future. I'll give you a short story and timeline of embryo biopsy attempts and technology and how it evolved. First time in 1952, Seidel and his co-workers biopsied rabbit embryo embryos. Tarkovsky and Wobleska in 1967 biopsied mouse embryos. Section of the rabbit blastocyst was accomplished by Gardner and Edwards in 1967. You can see here that Edwards and his co-workers were playing with the embryos as early as 1967, and it took them practically 10 plus years to eventually attempt the technology in humans, and they end up with the very first IVF baby in the world. Human oocyte polar biopsy was done in 1988 by Yuri Berlinsky. And the first pregnancy for biopsy embryo at the cleavage stage, which is the day three, was done to detect the gender of the baby, because they wanted to avoid an X-linked disorder, and that ended as a normal pregnancy with a disease-free baby. Now, that literally opened huge doors into the future for our specialty, and there has been an explosion of new technologies developed and refinements of older technologies and knowledge that was acquired utilizing those techniques and looking into the results and the data that we have accumulated. Nowadays, we have a technique which for biopsy of the embryo, which we think it's as good as it can get, at least for the time being. And we have abandoned the original technique that was used to biopsy the embryo that ended up as the first baby from a biopsied embryo. In vitro fertilization, we grow the embryos from conception, which is day zero, up to day five, where they reach this stage of the blastocyst. Embryo transfer can be done at any time during this period. We used to transfer day three embryos until we developed our culture media, but now they can allow the embryo to advance up to day five, which is a stage prior to implantation into the uterus. Day three embryos, they contain maximum 8 cells. So you have an embryo with 8 cells. Go to biopsy and you take out one embryo, you take out 12.5% of the entire embryo. You take 2 cells out, you take 25% out of this embryo. So that means you reduce genetic material for this embryo. And because those cells are totipotent, those cells can develop into anything. The problem that we had with this, although the technology, the technique was easy relative to what we do now, was that the pregnancy rate of embryos that had been biopsied at the blastocyst on day three was much lower than the pregnancy rate of embryos that were transferred without any biopsy. Now, that means that you cannot use this technology for improving pregnancy rates, reducing the miscarriage, and you can only use it to look into single gene disorders to do PGD. We abandoned this technique quite early because we detected that it affects the embryos. And it was not useful. It was really not useful unless we are cornered with our back on the wall and we had to detect a single gene disorder. Then we will do it. This slide shows a blastocyst. A blastocyst is an embryo grown, a day five embryo grown to the point that it is ready to implant into the uterus and start the pregnancy. If you notice in the periphery of this, there is a line which is called the zona pellucida. It's the shell of the egg in which the embryo is enclosed. This area here, it's called the blastocell. It's a cavity, it's a cyst filled with fluid. In that area here, we have the so-called embryoblast. We call it inner cell mass, which is the area where now the fetus will grow from. That area you cannot touch, because what you're gonna do is you're gonna end up with a fetus that might be missing a hand or an arm or a leg or something like this. The rest of the blastocyst are cells that will produce placenta and the membrane. Now, I am going to show you a video clip from an embryo biopsy at the blastocyst stage in our laboratory. Again, I'm showing you the blastocyst. Here you can see clearly the inner cell mass, which means that's what the baby is going to come. from. And you can see the trophoblasts all around. Now, what we do is we take cells, we biopsy the area that is opposite to the inner cell mass to be as far as possible from the developing fetus. We hold the blastocyst with a special pipette, you can see it here, and we can move the blastocyst wherever we want. This red circle that you see here is the focal point of our laser on the microscope. So by moving the blastocyst wherever we want to use the laser, we can use the laser with an extreme precision of microns. This here is another pipette which we use to biopsy the embryo and remove the cells. I'm going to play now the video and you're going to see what happens under the microscope. As you can see here, we move the blastocyst to bring the zona pellucida, that area here, in the focal point of the laser. We find the laser and we open a hole in the zona pellucida without touching or affecting even one cell of the blastocyst. You can see that the zona pellucida dissolved, and now the pipette that we use for the biopsy is introduced into the blastocyst, and we, by pushing on the blastocyst, we can touch it from the zona pellucida. And now you can see here the zona pellucida, which is the shell. Now this piece here is the shell that was very close to the laser, and we just remove it because we don't want to use it. The pipette now is introduced into the blastocyst, and you can see the embryologist directs it opposite to the area where the embryo will grow, and it aspirates in part of the trophoectoderm, and the laser fires slowly and cuts it. So we aim to collect anything between 5 to 7 cells. This is how much we need in order to have enough DNA to increase the accuracy of the genetic testing. Each cell contains approximately 7 picograms of DNA, and the more you have, the better it is, because the amplification procedure does not fail. The biopsy has been completed, the blastocyst is here, it's going to expand again, and then we freeze it until we get the results of the genetic testing. This graph here shows the results of 2 groups of patients. One group was given two blastocysts without testing them. And the other one was given 1 blastocyst, which was tested for normal chromosomal anomalies. You can see the pregnancy rate here. You can see the pregnancy rate here. The ones that we put, that they received 2 embryos, the pregnancy rate was slightly higher from the group that received 1 embryo, okay? Not significant, statistically significant. One was 69% and the other 72%, which is a huge, huge percentage, huge success rate. That reflects the improvements in the technologies that we use and also the improvement in the genetic testing. But if you see here, you can see that under the yellow line, which means that's the cutoff point to characterize a baby as low birth, you can see a large number of babies that were low birth, and that's a complication of the pregnancy. The red line is a very low birth weight, and you can see here several babies born that were very low weight, and that's also another complication of the twin pregnancy. Here you can see very few babies that are low birth weight, and most of them are very close to the normal, none very low birth weight. So it is very, very important that we reduce the number of the embryos that we transfer into the women that they want to conceive to 1, in order to avoid, to minimize the risk of twin pregnancy. You cannot eliminate it, because many embryos split in 2, and then you have a homozygote. So it seems like we're getting there, and at least in our group, we have practically eliminated twin transfers, even on the patients that they had a previous IVF. This is a kind of busy slide, and it shows the results of the genetic testing on embryos that were tested on day 3, which are the blue bars, and embryos that tested at the blastocyst stage, day 5, which are the red bars. By just looking at it, you say, whoa, when you do the biopsy on day 3, you have a much higher abnormal rate of embryos that are abnormal as compared to the blastocyst. Yeah, that's true. But that's only because as we grow the embryos from day 3 to day 5, they self-select, which means most of the embryos that are chromosomally abnormal, which you will detect it by biopsy at day 3, they're going to be dead. They will arrest. They will never make it to day 5. So they will not be available to be tested. Naturally, you're going to have a lower percentage of abnormal embryos. So you can see that in all 22 chromosomes, you have more or less abnormalities on all of them. Most of those abnormalities, they will never allow a pregnancy, which means we were not aware of pregnancies with these chromosomal abnormalities before, because pregnancy never happened. Now, with the advent of the biopsy in the embryo, we know that if they have an abnormality like this, they will never give us a pregnancy. Not that we want a pregnancy like this, but that will explain why we do not see this kind of abnormalities in abortuses from patients that had a miscarriage and we genetically tested the miscarriage embryo. Well, in 2017, we want to have the highest success rate. We want to reduce the multiple pregnancy, if possible, down to zero. And we want to reduce the complications associated with higher order pregnancies. And we want to have a very high success pregnancy rate, and knowing that we have transferred a normal embryo. So we are starting with the stimulation of the ovaries to collect eggs. We try to do a moderate intensity stimulation, collect a good number of eggs adequate for to create enough embryos to do genetic testing. We capture them to day 5 because we do not do day 3 biopsies just because they are not safe for the embryo. We do the PGS and then we transfer frozen embryos. The success rates have skyrocketed. Anything from 20% to 90% in the older groups, and from 50-60% to 90% for the younger groups. A long way with the elimination, or at least severe reduction of the complication of the daily practices, are twins and triplets. Future trends, what lies ahead for the field? Well, I don't have a crystal ball, but at least I can see a few things through the smoke, what's coming down the pipe. And we're going to have the NGS 2 and 3, which is nothing else but improved technology, improved protocols on the NGS system, which allows for faster run of the test, high throughput, improvement in cost. And this is something that I mentioned for the first time, and I want to tell you that we were fortunate that we are now able to offer this test practically to everybody, because the cost of genetic testing has come down from 10,000 down per embryo down to $800-$900 per embryo. I mean, this is an incredible progress, and the affordability of the test saves everybody, not only heartaches and failures and miscarriages, but also money. Because a miscarriage costs twice as much as a PGS test. Why would anyone risk to spend the money on a miscarriage and all the complications that can happen and not do the PGS testing? Whole genome sequencing. What we want to do in the future, and I hope it's going to come real quick, is we want to sequence the entire genome of the embryo. Everything. So we're going to look simultaneously, not only for chromosome numbers, but for single gene disorders, mutations, and also we will try to identify those genes that are responsible for a successful outcome when we transfer an embryo. Because transferring a chromosome in a normal embryo, it does not bring 100% success rate. It brings 80 to 90. We still have a 10% gap. And those pregnancies, not all of them end up as their deliveries, 10% of them or even more end up as miscarriages. Why? What makes the difference? We think that besides chromosomal normalcy, there are certain genes that are responsible for the success or failure of the procedure. And this is where we're going to aim to identify those genes. Then we're going to have the holy grail of embryo selection, and we're going to say, yes, now we can talk to patients and tell them to do it, and this is what's going to happen. Thank you for your attention. I will take questions.
Dr. Anthony Vasilas, our past president, and Dr. Ioannis Zivudakis. Since our theme tonight is obstetrics and gynecology, it is only fitting that we honor one of our very own MFMs. Dr. Zivudakis was an esteemed colleague, a friend, a mentor to me, and tonight his daughter, Dr. Alice Zivudakis, who is a hematologist-oncologist, will speak to us and give a short bio about her beloved dad. Alice.
Good evening. I would like to thank the Hellenic Medical Society, Dr. Diakonas and Dr. Chrysomalis for inviting me to present this tribute to my father this evening. Many of you in this audience knew him personally as a friend, a colleague, and a mentor. He greatly valued his membership in the Hellenic Medical Society was very involved in the Greek community. I'm a physician as well, so it's indeed a great honor for me tonight to be presenting this tribute. So my father, Dr. Zivudakis, was born in June 17, 1943 in Greece to his parents, Dr. Andreas Zivudakis, who was also an obstetrician and gynecologist, and Aliki Zivudaki, born Papa Leonardo. I'm named after my grandmother. Here's a photo of Dr. Zivudakis with his parents and his younger sister, Sophia. He was an associate attending obstetrician and gynecologist at New York Presbyterian Hospital and an associate professor of clinical obstetrics and gynecology at Weill Cornell Medical College. Dr. Zivudakis earned his medical degree from the University of Athens in 1963 and later received a PhD from there as well. After obtaining his medical degree in Athens, he completed his military service as a doctor in the Greek Navy. He came to the United States in 1970 and completed an internship at Coney Island Hospital, then a residency in obstetrics and gynecology at New York Hospital, Cornell University Medical Center. He served as the chief resident during his residency. He then went on to pursue a fellowship in maternal and fetal medicine, also at Cornell University Medical College. He practiced and taught at Weill Cornell Medical College since 1971, except for the period of 1979 to 1991, when he returned to Athens, Greece, to teach and practice at the Alexander Hospital and the Lito Maternity Hospital. He specialized in high-risk obstetrics, and his research led to the cessation of the practice of using ethanol to arrest premature labor, as it was not effective and was associated with decreased Apgar scores and with increased respiratory distress syndrome in newborns. He also developed new techniques in treating uterine fibroids and was a pioneer of the fetus as a patient concept. He devoted his life to the practice of medicine and estimated that he delivered over 20,000 babies during his career. Dr. Zervidakis was an active member of the Hellenic Medical Society and was honored by the Society in May 2015 when he was presented with a Lifetime Achievement Award at the Dr. George Papanikolaou Award Symposium at Cornell Medical College. And this was a very proud moment for my father. In addition to his very busy career, he was devoted to his family and enjoyed spending time with his wife, his children, and grandchildren. He enjoyed classical music, traveling and sailing, and he was also a gourmet chef in his free time. So on behalf of myself and my family, we would like to thank the Hellenic Medical Society for its contributions to medicine and to the Greek community. My dad was very proud to be part of such a wonderful organization and always supported other doctors and scientists in the community, including sponsoring many young physicians who came from Greece. Thank you very much.
Another person who we lost this year is Dr. Anthony Vasilas. For the sake of time, we are going to have a video that's going to go on the website and perhaps show it. Nice to say, Dr. Vasilas, who passed away this year, was not only one of the past presidents in the 1980s, he was also one of the founders and presidents of the Archangel Michael Church. He was the chairman of radiology at the Beekman Downtown Hospital. And most of all, in the 80s, he contributed himself over $40,000 to our scholarship program. He was perhaps the single-handed reason that there is a book that we currently have and have given out for George Papanikolaou that Dr. Vasilas printed and translated. And also with the Panagiotikos Society and the Federation of Hellenic Societies, the Hellenic Medical Society of New York began their scholarship at the Cornell Weill Hospital, the George Papanikolaou Scholarship, which exists today. And Dr. Vasilas and the leaders of the society at that time, who are, many of them are here in this room, were single-handedly responsible for it, and we thank them.
Hi, I'm the daughter of Anthony Vasilas, and I wanted to thank the Hellenic Medical Society for commemorating my dad for our family. He was devoted to the Hellenic Medical, and so this is an honor to speak with you tonight.
When you're a physician, you spend a lot of time with patients and with your work and with work needs, especially now, of course, more than ever. And many times these sacrifices affect your family life and your personal life and your social life. And you look back, or at least many times I look back, and I wonder, what will people remember me for? And what will my family be able to say about me? One of the things that we hope is to leave a mark somehow. Dr. Anthony Vasilas, whom we lost this year, was one of those people that left a very strong mark on the society. The Medical Society was revitalized during his era as president and his era as an active member of the board, along with many other doctors as well. But one cannot deny that if we look back and wonder what kind of mark we left and what will we be remembered for, Dr. Vasilas is remembered for many, many things by many of the members and board members and past presidents and administrators that the society has had.
At some point this holiday season, we hope that you can all take a moment to stop and reflect on people like Dr. Zervidakis and Dr. Vasilas. One day, we all hope to be remembered, but more importantly, many of us deserve to be remembered. May their memory be eternal, and we thank them for all of their support. Dr. Move to the next section of our program, which is the scholarship awards.
The emphasis on medicine, bringing therapies to patients, understanding the ailing, your ailing fellow human, such a great component that I was just proud to have been there to show other people of other cultures of how important our contributions are. And really, that seems to have, it's taken over a huge component of me. And today, I've even brought my oldest son, Yoro, who I'm hoping one day he's going to be in the audience and saying, "Dad, I think I'm going to get the scholarship." But I'm hoping that this is the future. This is how we're going to do it. And this is how it's going to keep going, because this is what makes it all worthwhile. So, number one, congratulations, not to the people that got the scholarships, but to the parents, to the community that helped them grow up and become the great people that they are, to the young recipients, the high school recipients who did a wonderful job in writing essays, showing the promise of what they have in their future, and then also the people who are somewhere in between that are deciding their fate and where they want to go and what they want to do. And I like to think that at some point, this wonderful organization, this association that has gone together, that has joined itself in the community, can play a huge role and allow these people to really, I think, bring the best out of them and have them become physicians, anything that's within the medical, and really kind of get in touch with our heritage, our culture, and who we are, and to continue this. And my hopes are to all of you that you will continue doing what we're doing today for the next generation. So congratulations to the parents. And now I'm going to start calling on the names, but we're going to do the High School Essay Awards first. It's sponsored by Dr. Studios and Vivian Lazinti's Hellenic Fund. So we have three recipients of the High School Essay Award.
If you like, I'll call them out for you.
Wonderful. Mr. Raphael Kiru.
Congratulations.
Very nice essay. Nina Veru. And I'm very proud also because I know the young man for the past few years, and it's great to see him. Theodoros Karanikolas. And thank you again to Dr. Vizikis and his family for this one. This is a certificate of merit, and this is what I referred to before, of students who are in between before they get into a medical school. So we have two wonderful students who have done an incredible job. And based on their merit, they've gotten the certificate. George Danyas. Eleni Eustathiades. Gabriel Memorial Scholarship goes to Alexander Duke. Dr. Olivia Scorillo's Memorial Scholarship goes to Kelly Yerudis. Dr. James and Lina Starosius Memorial Scholarship goes to Christos Mouzakidis. Dr. James Nicholas Memorial Scholarship goes to Vasiliki Papagermanos. Maria is actually out of state at a rotation, and that's what she should be. So, good. The Dr. Anthony and Sophia Vasilas Memorial Scholarship goes to Alexei Tsakonas. So, congratulations to him anyway. And the Hellenic Medical Society New York Scholarship goes to Sophia Zigouras. Great. And we also have the Dr. Gloria Papanicolaou Award and there's two other Gloria Santos. Michael Flores.
PhD dissertation, where I'm
trying to do is revolutionize spinal fusion surgery so that we can move away from using titanium implants that remain in the body over time to using 3D printed patient customized bone scaffolds that we can actually see with the patient's own cells so that we're implanting an implant that is made of the patient's own biological material that will eventually disappear over time, in short. Thank you. Inspiration and support, and I'm really lucky to have her in my life. A little bit about me. I'm originally from Chicago. I just graduated college from Trinity College in Hartford, Connecticut. And I, this summer, started my job at NYU Langone Medical Center as a clinical research associate doing melanoma research. And then I do a lot of different things, so I collect a lot of patient information from the medical charts, but I also get to interact with the medical oncologists and accruing these patients, as well as working with them in different projects. So one of the projects I'm currently working on is analyzing different surgical procedures with survival outcome. So it's very, very exciting, and I'm very honored to be here tonight. Thank you very much for your generous support.
I'm originally from Astoria, and a little bit more about myself. I went to undergrad at Michigan, so it's really nice to be back in New York. Welcomed by the Hellenic Medical Society. I am a second year medical student at SUNY Downstate, and medical school has been good. So I'm not working on any life-changing projects, research projects currently. And my main concern is the USMLE. But I'm very grateful to the Hellenic Medical Society. It's a great honor to be here tonight. I appreciate all the mentors that we have in the room and the families that support us. And the community is incredible. And I really look forward to being able to give back in the future.
My name is Alex Duke. I just wanted to thank the Hellenic Medical Society for tonight. It's an honor to be here, and for the scholarship committee for recognizing me. And I also just want to thank my parents, my mom, and my Yahoo, who are both here with me tonight. Without them, I certainly wouldn't be up here or in front of you right now. A little bit about me. I'm a fourth year medical student from Stony Brook University, currently applying for orthopedic surgery. I'm also doing research within vascular surgery, but most of my research is looking at biomechanical data for fractures. But I hope to, in the long term, I was a plant science major at Cornell, and I'm hoping to combine those two passions, orthopedics and plants, and look at the healing properties that several plant compounds have in healing fractures in the future. Thank you.
Bravo.
Good evening, my name is Kelly Gerbutis. I am a fourth year medical student at Mount Sinai School of Medicine while also getting my master's in clinical research. I'm currently doing a project within the field of autism and neurodevelopmental disease. My hope is by learning how to ask the right questions, we'll eventually figure out the true biology underneath mental processes. I want to make a huge, huge thank you to my family and also to the Hellenic Medical Society and to Dr. Kousoumadis, who has made all of this possible, has changed my life by taking all of us under her wings. She's really brought us to places where we never thought we could be.
Good evening, my name is Christophoros Kumbas. I'm from Bayside, Queens. I'm a third year medical student at what's now the Zucker School of Medicine at Hofstra, Northwell. I wanted to say how pleased and excited I am to be part of this organization that allows us to celebrate Greek culture and heritage and also collaborate together to achieve success both in medicine and in life. I'd like to thank the Hellenic Medical Society and all of their generous donors who year after year show that they're invested in relieving the financial burden on their young medical students and young scientists. Last thing I want to say, as a first-generation Greek and Cypriot American citizen, I'd like to say thank you to my parents and grandparents, and also to all the parents and grandparents out here, because the sacrifices that they made when they came here provided you the opportunities and the career choices that we have today. So that's not to be taken for granted.
I'm Christo Muzakiti. I hail from SUNY Upstate in Syracuse, so I had to battle a few blizzards on my way down, but that's okay. I just wanted to say thank you to the Society for just taking an interest in me and supporting my dreams as a high school student, the SA Scholarship, the SA Award, as an undergrad with a research grant, and now as a medical student with this very generous scholarship. And I will do my best to contribute to our reputation as a very capable and very compassionate and pioneering people. Hopefully one day I can stand at this podium and give back to the next generation. Thank you.
I'm a third-year medical student at the Zucker School of Medicine at Hofstra Northwell. We have a long name now. And I'd like to thank the Hellenic Medical Society for supporting me and all of our students here. I'd like to share a little story. I'm a third-year medical student, as I just said, and the support that I felt from other members of the Hellenic Medical Society that had previously received support and are now physicians at North Shore, such as Dr. Kasoulis that I see in the audience, and Dr. Spagianos, who was a great mentor to me in surgery most recently. So the effects of the society are far and through, more so from this room. So I'd like to thank you again.
And I'm from East Northport, Long Island. I was really humbled and honored to be selected last year for the scholarship, and I've really enjoyed meeting everyone a part of the Hellenic Medical Society. It's such a warm community, a great network of people, and I really just felt welcome from day one, so thank you so much for that. I also appreciate the generosity of the donors. It really makes a difference to have the financial support to get through medical school. I know my family and I are very appreciative of that. I'd also like to thank my family, of course, for all of the support throughout the years. I do have a personal connection to autism, which motivated me to go into medicine. So I hope to treat adults and children with autism as a physician. Thank you.
Hello, my name is Sophia Zagoris. I'm from Tenafly, New Jersey, and I'd like to express my sincere gratitude to the Scholarship Committee and the Hellenic Medical Society. I recently learned that the Hellenic Medical Society was able to attend the Youth Initiative event, which was wonderful, and it's been nice to meet some of you, and I look forward to meeting more of you soon. I also can't wait to be here one day, potentially giving scholarships to the next generation of doctors. I am very grateful to the Greek community. I think it's helped to shape who I am as a person, and a lot of my passion I credit to my Greek background. I'd like to thank my parents for their support. I couldn't be doing this without them. My journey to medicine and attending as a second year medical student at NYITCOM is that I studied nutrition at Cornell, and I was really fascinated by metabolism and digestion. So I became a registered dietitian with a master's in nutrition. And working in the hospital, I just wanted to keep learning more and doing more. And I see myself potentially becoming a gastroenterologist and incorporating my nutrition background to help patients as the best possible doctor I can. Thank you.
Good evening, my name is Marcus Sedaris. I'm a second year at Weill Cornell Medical College. I just wanted to thank you all for your support and recognition of all of us. Having Greek role models has always been important to me, especially modern ones like Dr. Papanikolaou. And now at Cornell, there's a bust of him in our main hallway, so I walk by him a couple times a day and I'm reminded of this legacy. So thank you for helping continue to support that and all of us.
Hi, good evening. My name is Christopher Santos. I'm a third year at Rothbard Medical College. I'm receiving the George Bobby-Brown Scholarship with Michael. I'm incredibly honored to be receiving this award, especially one named after Dr. Papanikolaou, who, as we all know, helped develop cervical cancer screening, the Pap test, because let's be honest, no number can say Papanikolaou. So thank you, I'm very humbled. I want to thank the Planet Medical Society, Dr. Lorraine Krishnamalis for all her work with the youth, and of course my family, my parents, my yaya, my brothers who are all here.
Our future role models, our future presidents and members of the board of the Hellenic Medical Society, once again. So as we close tonight's event, let me once again bring and remind you that tomorrow we celebrate our 81st annual gala at the Essex House. So this year's, again, distinguished physician is Dr. George Kofinas, if you please will come up again. This year's distinguished colleague is Dr. Florentia Kisodulidou. Congratulations to you as well, and we look forward to a wonderful event tomorrow night. There is a journal that is published during this event tomorrow, and that journal ultimately will make its way to the website. For all of you that are there, we encourage you to flip through it. For those that are not there, we encourage you to go to the website. But a shameless plug to remind everybody that all of their thanks goes to all of you who have already contributed, Dr. Tambakis, and Dr. Pauline, your husband, and so many other people, Dr. Mazitis, and so many other people in this audience, of course. Also, we hope to see all of you tomorrow night at our annual gala event, which is at the Essex House. And for our honorees tomorrow, we have a number of dignitaries that are gonna be there, and they too are just thrilled to be a part of the event. But seriously, we really look forward to the scholarship awardees as being future leaders of this society. And from the bottom of the board's hearts, we absolutely thank you all for being here. So thank you very much for all of your support. But please remind the people that you think might have been qualified to not forget us next year.
Dr. George Kofinas, Reproductive Endocrinology and Fertility. Τιμήσαμε τα νέα παιδιά που είναι σε biomedical research και στην ιατρική σχολή. Θέλουμε να τους δείξουμε πόσο πολύ μας ενδιαφέρει ότι προοδεύουν και θέλουμε να τους βοηθήσουμε να πετύχουν και να πάρουν τη σκητάλη για το μέλλον και με τη στράση να βοηθήσουν άλλους νέους.
Good evening. This is Dr. Marinos Petratos, past president of the Hellenic Medical Society and founder of the Scholarship Fund. The Scholarship Fund, when we first started, we were given $500, two scholarships of $500, and we are now in the range of $40,000 to $50,000 worth of scholarships every year. The effort has been extremely successful. We have a lot of cooperation, we have a lot of donors, we have a lot of hard fundraisers. The Hellenic Medical Society loves to sponsor young students. We have high school scholarships for high school students. We have scholarships for college students. And we, of course, have our ultimate scholarship for medical students.
The new MDs are fantastic. It's so good to see so many young people and the society growing. And we have a huge future, a great future, bright future. And I hope they're also going to be members and they're going to keep the tradition on. Very proud of them. This is one of the best nights we've seen so far. Thank you.
We had a great event this evening. We were very honored to see the number of scholarship recipients, which is increasing every year. And it really holds great promise for the society and for the future of medicine, hearing about the great achievements and the interests of these young people who are very deserving.
Yes, congratulations to the Hellenic Medical Society of New York, Dr. Spiros Mazitis, past president of the Hellenic Medical Society of New York and president and founder of the Federation of Hellenic Medical Societies of North America. We are very proud to have so many scholarship recipients tonight, December 1st. 2017 in New York City at Lenox Hill Hospital Einhorn Auditorium. We are proud of our president, Dr. George Lakias, and Dr. Sotirios Teriopoulos of the Scholarship Committee, and Dr. Lorraine Chrysomalis Valasiadis, who did so much work to get the Greek-American community, young people together, interested in science and receiving awards. We plan to continue this every year, and outreach to the community. I ask for the community to support the Hellenic Medical Society, to support our Greek-American scientists, and all together we can move forward in making impact in the U.S. society. We're proud of our heritage, proud of our culture, proud to be Greek-Americans.
As the years go by, we see more and more great students. We see more and more great promise for our future, and especially for our Hellenic heritage. And seeing our strength in medicine is a wonderful thing.
That was our annual scholarship symposium. I think the students spoke for themselves. Their work was incredible. Oxy. We look forward not only to wonderful things and leadership in the medical community, but also in the Hellenic Medical Society.
It's great to give back to students, and hopefully they'll do that as well one day. Thank you very much.
Thank you, MGTV, for always covering our events, and we'll look forward to seeing you again.
MGTV USA. Οι δραστηριότητες της ελληνοαμερικανικής κοινότητας με βίντεο και πλήρες ρεπορτάζ. Επισκεφτείτε την ιστοσελίδα μας mgtvusa.com. Καλύπτουμε καθημερινά τα γεγονότα στην Ομογένεια.